afternoon and welcome to About Health. My name is Thuy Nguyen and I'll be your host for today's show. I'm the founder and director of Brooklyn Community Acupuncture, BCA, a clinic aimed at making acupuncture more accessible to more people. There are 4 licensed acupuncturists at Brooklyn Community Acupuncture. If you've been to our clinic recently, you have probably seen one of us, Rosemary, Andrea, Ipe, or myself, Thuy, for acupuncture. We all practice traditional Chinese medicine, or TCM, and even so, our unique personalities may have more impact on your treatment than you might think. At the heart of it, TCM is not a static formulaic medicine. There isn't one set way to do a particular thing for a particular ailment, like headache or back pain or insomnia. There are 361 points on the main meridians and hundreds more than that, and the possible point combinations are uncountable. There are also at least as many herbs to choose from. In addition, there are a variety of approaches, schools of thoughts, and leanings that's unique for each practitioner. For example, some practitioners emphasize herbs or diet, while others may have a more spiritual approach. If this all sounds vast and somewhat complicated to you, well, it kind of is. And maybe that's why TCM is often referred to as an art, flexible, creative, with unlimited possibilities. But that's not all it is. TCM's efficacy is also backed by science through tests and clinical trials. So TCM is a combination of science and art, medicine and metaphysical. It's by nature flexible, adaptable, and creative. And because of this, like art, it is an expression and extension of the individual that practices it. To help explain the depth and breadth of this beautiful medicine, I had the idea to ask the other practitioners at BCA to join me for a casual conversation about traditional Chinese medicine to help patients understand a little more about it. Interestingly, what unfolded was more of a peek into the minds of the acupuncturist, at least the ones at BCA, how we ourselves orient to the medicine and the things that we consider that may not be apparent to you when we treat you.
Acupuncturists as a group were very politically inactive. And so, you know, they talk about how the practice as a profession is in trouble.
Right? Oh,
because,
really?
Yes, because there are so many other practitioners of other modalities that are using things that they call acupuncture. And the public doesn't necessarily know what the difference is. You know, they call it dry needling,
yeah.
Or even now nutrition counseling or moxa or all sorts of other gua sha cupping, right? All sorts of other groups do it. And there's no reason to have a turf war. Something I just heard recently where they're trying to include acupuncture, or it already has been. Acupuncturists can work for Medicare, I think, except for the fact that acupuncturists as an entity are not a practice recognized by the federal government. So I'm just thinking in terms of being able to bring this practice out to many more people, like seniors, and so maybe
it's like we're still getting legitimized in the greater medical world,
this kind of thing. Right. We're on the verge. We could conceivably treat so many people or have access to seniors on Medicare, but until we're recognized as an actual profession by the federal government, it's not going to happen. And so they're introducing legislation to try to do this. And so
I feel like it's a mixed bag to be legitimized, because you're legitimized to another system's way of understanding medicine.
But not necessarily, as long as we stand firm, because we know what our medicine is. And so you might be legitimized in their system, because that's the only way for us to be able to treat people in their system. But the way we treat the people in their system is the way we treat.
Uh-huh.
Right? And then even then, you know, the way each of us treats is different from each other. So it's like, what is the right way? It's whatever way works for the patient. And if it doesn't, that means they need to go to someone else. And they will. And then they'll find the right person. So
Ipe brought up some things to think about for us as a profession. It is true that acupuncturists as a whole tend to be politically inactive. I know this because I myself am not active in that way, in terms of lobbying for my profession as a whole. I am active in education if this radio show is any indication, but the type of lobbying and politics involved in gaining legitimacy and recognition within the larger systems isn't really my jam. However, there are some things that Ipe brought up that does get under my skin, like the fact that we are not recognized as healthcare workers by the federal government, and the casual co-opting of traditional Chinese medicine techniques by other groups, including what is called dry needling, which is 54 hours of training for physical therapists compared to upwards 3,000 hours of training for acupuncture. Chiropractors and medical doctors are allowed to practice what they also call acupuncture with a few more hours than the dry needling. How is that possible? If we take the art and world view out of TCM, then acupuncture can be reduced down to prescriptive points and techniques that can be learned in a relatively short period of time. But that isn't really traditional Chinese medicine. That's using the tools of TCM in a reductive modern Western way. And while that can still quote unquote work for things like reducing pain and discomfort short term, what is lost when we mistake that for traditional Chinese medicine is a greater medicine, a beautiful and deep medicine that teaches wellness and how to live medicine, both individually and collectively. Ipe goes on to talk about acupuncturists being primary care practitioners.
It's hard because I know, look, California acupuncturists are, you know, primary care practitioners. Right now, I certainly don't consider myself that. But in thinking about it this year, I was thinking, maybe I should revisit that more. But it's not a primary care practitioner in the Western sense because I'm not a doctor. But the fact that I can be that, I definitely want to be more active and involved and start thinking about it that way rather than...
You are that.
That's true. And so I just want to think more in terms of that because I didn't before.
Right.
Well, for one thing, I don't practice enough hours to feel like I'm going to do that, which means that maybe I need to practice more hours.
Well, I mean, I think in general, too, maybe for whatever reasons, it's hard for us to really understand and accept our impact on patients. That I do think that we have a profound effect as a, primary care, meaning the person that gives them the most relief for their health.
Yeah.
In California, acupuncturists are primary care providers, or PCPs. PCPs are the person a patient sees regularly for general health and well-being, understands you over time, gives general assessments, and coordinates care with other health providers if needed. In essence, I think of PCPs as family doctors. I do recognize myself as that person for many of my patients, though I also shy away from using that term. Perhaps that term feels too synonymous with the powers accorded to medical doctors in Western medicine, that it feels ill-fitting. And for some of us, it's not just because we see our medicine as different from Western medicine, but we've been so conditioned by the powers that be to not think of ourselves as primary anything. After all, the more common designation of our medicine is as alternative or complementary, and we're not legally allowed to call ourselves doctors. I have mixed feelings about being accorded legitimate Western labels and standing within a system that simultaneously doesn't take me all that seriously. I'd prefer to see the way of thinking of the systems themselves change to reflect an understanding of interconnectedness, highlighting prevention, empowerment, and holistic care. Until that happens, fitting acupuncture into the current system of medicine necessarily reduces TCM down to the reductive compartment that Western medicine accords it. I do appreciate Ipe's position that perhaps that's where change can begin, from the inside. As for me, I tend to do my work locating wellness outside the thinking of those systems. Everyone has their particular orientation to the systems that we necessarily live in and are affected by, and around what it means to be a licensed acupuncturist, what it means to be a primary care physician, and ultimately what it means to participate in this world we are all connected to. It's a deep question about identity. Rosemary talked about her relationship to the identity of being an acupuncturist.
I'm a person who enjoys all the different things that you can use to relate to the world, and that is things that are a little bit more literal and things that are more subtle. And the acupuncture is, in some ways, something that's more subtle, even though, you know, it's not just subtle, it's also, there's a science to it as well. Just as a person who enjoys sort of the breadth of what reality has to offer and enjoys that process, I guess, acupuncture in that way.
That's interesting that it's not like a core thing that comes to your mind when you think about yourself.
No, it's if I talk to someone and, you know, when you're talking in linear ways with people and you're like, oh, what do you do? I mean, it is, but it's not really, the most important thing isn't that. The most important thing is when I think of myself, I am somebody who likes to engage in a lot of different aspects of life, and it's, and that's what I enjoy about acupuncture. It allows to interact with ideas and people in a way that's, yeah, just the fact that I can use a different system that is not something that I grew up with, mm-hmm. is also sort of liberating, because it takes certain assumptions out of that interaction, and I find that exciting and fun. So I guess as maybe more of a tool to be who I am is what acupuncture provides. And it's an important tool, but it's not like I need to put needles in people. That's who I am, you know, or I need to.
Well, I mean, I remember when you took the break, you told me, you're like, I don't miss it. That's news to me that I don't miss it.
Yeah,
I remember.
Yeah. Because if the idea of what we're doing is interacting with people in a certain way and passing on some kind of a healing, it doesn't have to be with needles. It can just be by looking at someone on the street. It was actually fun to not do acupuncture and still feel like I was doing some of the same stuff. I don't need to do acupuncture to interact with the world in that way. But acupuncture is a great and a fun way to do that, you know?
So maybe it's not acupuncturist, it's healer. I mean, the baseline.
But it's not exactly, it is healer in a way, but it's more just like...
present to the energetics.
It's something about the interaction, because it's not just one directional, like I get healed too. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So it's something about the interaction rather than I'm giving you this thing. Sometimes I am giving you this thing, sometimes you're giving me this thing. So it is very much like just kind of like a energetic dance or something, you know?
Yeah. I think it took me a while to use that word really comfortably, to feel like, oh yeah, and what do you do? Oh, I'm an acupuncturist. I would use body worker to lead a lot for a long time first, which is funny because I didn't necessarily ever do it anymore, but felt like less pressure or something somehow. I think maybe in a way it is a little bit, if I'm understanding you correctly, Rosemary, kind of like a little bit of a shorthand way to maybe cue people into being open to a different kind of spectrum than if I was somebody who worked at a bank. You know, it's just kind of like, oh, what is that? Like, I don't really get it. I'm like, me neither. Let's talk about it.
It's how you identify yourself at parties when people are like, hey, hi, I'm Andrea. I'm an acupuncturist.
No, I don't throw it out there if that comes up. Like, but yeah, I mean, it's in there with a bunch of things. Like, there's not any other thing that I would necessarily say that would convey those same ideas.
Listening to KPFA 94.1's About Health. I'm Thuy Nguyen, your host, and I'm talking to other practitioners at Berkeley Community Acupuncture about what it means to be an acupuncturist. For the most part, acupuncturists have a perspective of the world that is more energetic than material. We see qi, or energy, or more precisely, we feel qi. So in a way, our attention is tuned into the invisible patterns behind what we see with our eyes. Seeing patterns of energy itself and understanding how it responds and shifts, not just with needles, but with any interaction, is what Rosemary is alluding to. Maybe that's why acupuncture tends to be glommed in with other fields and practices associated with metaphysics. These associations can put TCM in categories that discredit it to the more mainstream, validated systems of Western thought. Each of us relates to these associations in different ways, and it was interesting to explore this topic with the acupuncturists.
You know, the way the Western science goes, the way that I'm using it is very linear.
And Chinese medicine is a little bit more like allowing all kinds of just weird shit. So.
Yeah. Do you ever try to bring that into?
Usually
it's
not.
Hard.
I don't keep trying to
be holistic, and people just think you're nuts. Yeah. But I'll keep working on it.
I think mine is a little different. Yours is probably much more sciencey. So yeah, I don't feel like they're so mutually exclusive because I'm talking with people and providers
still
about health.
That's true.
It's public health, so it's a little different.
That's but too.
Yeah, I like going off the rails with just weird information. But anyway, it's just fun like talking about things that aren't scientific because it's like the world is a big place and we think we know all these things. And there's certain things we know in certain ways, and I don't know. It's just fun because. I'm not terribly married to everything. It's all sort of like a way to describe our reality. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean that that's what our actual reality is. So it's like tools that we use to, navigate our experience. So to me, it's like, okay, well, this versus that, they're both like different descriptions. They're not necessarily one is better than the other. And so that's why it's fun to just have multiple ones, because it's like, it's all just describing what our experience is. And one is just less commonly employed in certain circles, like scientific or, mainstream circles. So, and that's fun.
I mean, this feels like a hot topic for me because I feel there's an internal pressure to validate myself in the mainstream circles and giving myself permission to not always have to do that, even to myself, because I think that our world is run by, I don't think that most people think there's just different ways of seeing things. I think there's a right way of seeing things, and that right way will allow a certain amount of deviance from it that feels acceptable. And then beyond that, you lose credibility or you lose something. And always, I think living in this world and having a pulse on what is acceptable, what isn't, and always trying to fit into that, but also listen to your own calling, which might be outside of that, feels like always an issue for me.
Yeah, I could see why that's more of an issue for you, because you're kind of taking Chinese medicine out into the world and sort of, you're a little bit more, I think, I don't know how to say, like a spokesperson for Chinese medicine in a way that I'm not, so I don't have to care about.
But what even in your own circles, you don't. You have cool enough, crazy enough friends where they're like, whatever. It's not like they're questioning.
No, they definitely question. Some people are questioning, and I'm like, I don't need to explain it to you. Because I don't need to. Yeah, I know it works. And if you don't want to do it, I don't need to tell you why you need to do it. You know what I mean? So it's like, I'm just going to say this thing, and you just gave me a look like I'm crazy, and that's fine. Like, maybe if you have a question about it later, you can come to me. And if you don't want to do it, I don't care.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
But if I was trying to represent Chinese medicine and talk with other people as sort of a leader, then I could see that being certainly more of an issue.
Yeah. What's your relationship with that stuff?
I don't feel too much like they're representative in big ways, but doing the my abdominal massage or different things like that, people will be like, oh, but you're like an acupuncturist, right? What do you think about that? But it's different. I think already there, people are already kind of like, they're drinking the Kool-Aid already. So I'm not like convincing people.
Mm-hmm.
It's just kind of like another take, and people are like, oh, well, cool. I didn't know that they thought of it that way. Great. Right. I mean, I think family thought it was a little bit weird and probably still thinks it's sometimes weird, but sometimes they'll let me employ it, or employ me to use it or something. Yeah, I get excited about sharing it with people, kind of shifting a little bit of a perspective, helping people see that, like, normal is weird, or what they think is normal is common and not necessarily the way that it has to be. Like, reminding people that, like, oh, you don't really have to have, like, super painful periods all the time. Or, that's a big one that comes up all the time.
It's interesting to think about what is commonly accepted as normal in the mainstream. Painful periods is one thing that Andrea pointed to, and I find that people put up with pain and stress of all sorts that don't cross a certain debilitating threshold and consider that normal life. And yet, they feel that sensitivity to energy or chi is straying off into weird, crazy land. Pain or discomfort of any kind is not quote-unquote normal. It's an indication that there is some sort of chi or energy blockage. Qi is not a weird, mysterious thing that acupuncturists have special access to through needles. It's a thing that you feel and have access to and are affecting, whether you're aware of it or not. Pain is the more unpleasant awareness of feeling your qi. Qi is such an innate part of our experience that we take it for granted. Understanding qi in our bodies and that we affect qi with our thoughts, our emotions, our habits, can tune us into what our bodies are telling us and can help us make better choices for health and well-being. As acupuncturists, we also strive to maintain health and well-being. Treating ourselves through acupuncture and herbs can be tricky as we take on the role of both patient and practitioner. We had a discussion about how each of us navigates this tricky terrain of self-care.
I mean, I'm probably better at treating myself if I'm sick, if there's like a cold or something is coming on, or I don't feel like sore throat, or, you know, I tweak my knee or something like that. But on a more general level, I'm not always very good about it.
Is it because it takes time and you don't feel like you have time? Or
no, I don't know. Sometimes I'm like, oh, I have this tool. It's amazing. It's portable. I can do it on myself. I just don't. It's like I can't give people such a hard time for not making themselves the time because it's so easy for me not to do the same thing.
Yeah.
So sometimes somebody will come in and I really had to like give them a talking to about it, and then I'll be like, okay, you got to go home and do something for yourself too.
Yeah, that's so true.
They help me treat myself better.
Yeah, it's actually true. I had a patient come in and she was just like, you know, just freaking out, and I was like, I totally know how you feel. And so then I talked her down and I was like, okay, I'm talking myself down at the same time. And I'm like, this is so helpful, you know?
I don't know how many times I've told a person, I was like, thank you. I needed you to come in today so that I could hear that too.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, totally.
Because it's true.
And it's like, we just need to take better care of ourselves. Why does it take somebody else outside? But you know, I mean, there's a lot of reasons for that, but it is so helpful, right? Because it's like, oh yes, this is what I would do for a patient or somebody I care about. Say these things, and I could say that to myself too. So yeah.
Treating as affirmation.
Yes.
Right?
Like. Yeah, totally. Totally.
Yeah.
I do treat myself, but almost more for, you know, wellness. I realize that when I'm actually sick, if it's a cold, it's great. I just take herbs. That's easy. You can identify it easily. But I noticed that when I caught COVID, I was like, I couldn't remember what to do. And it was so funny because I was going along, I was taking herbs. I wasn't needling because that just felt wrong. It's like, I'm not gonna, you know, you just don't want to. But it's like the most basic thing. I'm sitting here going, boy, I'm quarantined in my bedroom, it's Christmas, and I'm grumpy, and I'm really irritable, I'm just grumpy. And I don't even know how long it took before I finally went, oh, hold on a minute, I need some shiatsu. This is just liver qi stagnation I'm dealing with right now at this point. And so you kind of forget if you're really ill, and I think that's the hard part. But otherwise, I guess it's good to do wellness, see? Mm. Set a good example. I have to say, I don't experience that where because I'm always trying to be okay. But I guess it's good to remember.
No, like, I feel like I said that, like, I'll treat myself when I'm getting sick, but it's like, if it's minor. When I got COVID, it was definitely like, what do I take? Will somebody treat me? Right. What do I do? Totally, what should I do?
Right, right. I feel like so much of it is sort of being able to set an example. So part of it is hard when you're going, wow, you know, I'm telling people all of these things to do. I'm making these recommendations. And shouldn't I be able to follow these myself? It's like, isn't the best part of teaching is to be able to set it as an example, that kind of thing. So
do you have that feeling like, oh, if I'm telling them something, I should be doing it?
No, not that often. Because when I'm telling people to do something, I do it.
Yeah.
But it is helpful to do acupuncture on yourself because then you know how horrible certain points feel. You know, so then when you do it on someone,
it doesn't work as well. It really is better if someone else needles you.
I think so,
because
it's a different experience altogether.
It's also energetically, because it's like you're looping in on yourself. So energetically, when you're giving acupuncture, you are giving, you know, some of that to the person, or you're channeling it somewhere. So if you're just needling yourself, you know, it's just like a closed loop. You're not gaining any extra energy unless you're doing something else, I suppose, like, you know, Qigong or Reiki or whatever. That's how I feel. But I know that it's still doing something because remember, when my nervous system is calm, that's when the body is healing itself. So that part I listen to.
I feel like the challenge for me is trying to DTCM conceptually and not the tool part yet. I mean, I'll do the tool part when I'm feeling especially bad, but, you know, like the stuff I talk about in the radio shows. Feeling how to be in life so that you don't get sick, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Recognizing where my chi is stagnant, where my stress is, where I'm angry at somebody, where I'm, like all the fictions that create our illness, like recognizing that and doing something about that is an ongoing humbling practice for me. And then the needling myself does come in, and I think that there's entering this stage of life where it's definitely, it's not just liver chi stagnation, but it's like yin deficiency now. Mm-hmm. And like, what the heck? Like feeling mortal, feeling like a person, feeling like you're not gonna have this endless youth, because I've been lucky enough to have been blessed with a healthy body all my life, but at some point you have to take care of yourself. So like learning what that means, learning how to take care of yourself. I mean, I think it's part of why I love Chinese medicine. It's also the challenge. Like, can you live Chinese medicine? It's very humbling, you know, right? It's just making peace with all the things that feel disharmonious and like really looking at it so that I can make peace with it. And like, I don't know. I don't even know the I was going to say be a better practitioner, but it's more like be present, you know? I think also because my understanding of medicine, it changes.
I mean, that's a really good point that you bring up, that connection between your behavior and then the symptom. Because, you know, there are times when, you know, it feels like somebody has a problem and it's the problem is coming from some kind of unhealthy life practice. So it's like if you treat this person, you got to address the unhealthy, the root cause of it. And if you're not addressing the root cause, then you're just,
right. Yeah,
it's almost like you're enabling this unhealthy thing. So there has to, you know, to treat it, but also to do some education around it.
We can say that there are two aspects of TCM, one of prevention and one of treatment. Prevention entails the adoption of an interconnected worldview of which we strive to maintain balance and harmony with all inherent relationships. People relationships, our relationship to nature, often emphasized in seasons, our relationship to work and study, and also our relationship to spirit, although this is less emphasized in our modern life. Acupuncture, bodywork, and herbs typically come in when imbalances have manifested into physical disease, and that is usually when patients come into our clinic seeking relief from pain. And our tools are often powerful remedies for such pain and discomfort. Acupuncture and herbs can treat pain of all sorts, musculoskeletal pain, repetitive stress injury, headache and digestive pain, menstrual pain, as well as treat imbalances of organ systems, anxiety and depression, fatigue and burnout, and so much more. The efficacy of these treatments is what TCM is most known for. And there is another aspect of the medicine that perhaps goes unnoticed, but to me is even more powerful. Learning how to stay well. That part, the prevention part and understanding how to live TCM, is the part we like to emphasize at BCA, even after the tools have restored you back to health. Thank you for listening to 94.1 KPFA's About Health. My name is Thuy Nguyen, and I'm talking about what it means to practice traditional Chinese medicine as a way of life. Connecting our patients to all aspects of their life that affect their health that they may not have connected to before helps them understand the impact of all things on their health and therefore empowers them to choose wisely for their health and well-being. This way of looking at relationships with people or things is what we try to convey as acupuncturists. Oftentimes, it's helping shift a patient's worldview, one where things are connected rather than separate, And in doing so, they can get a better handle of the problem. Doing this can be challenging in any circumstance, but trying to do it with the time constraints of community acupuncture requires some creativity. I asked the group what is challenging for them about practicing TCM, and everyone said the time constraint.
Yeah, time management. Yeah. Just making sure to stay on track. And what happens is I kind of get sucked in, and then you want to keep talking and find out more information. And I like talking to people, and so that slows me down a little bit. And then if you're running late, then the next person, so there's a cascading effect. So you're best off coming in like 1, 2, 3 in my clinic. Nice. But don't come in at noon because, you know, no. I've gotten better. So
I think it's hard to treat people in 10 or 15 minutes.
So it's the time thing because you said the time frame. Thing.
Yeah, I mean, I like the idea of community acupuncture and getting more people in so people don't have to pay as much. But I do find that challenging. Which is why I like abdominal massage, because you get more time with a person. So, you know, because sometimes you're like, why does it feel this way? And you have a little bit of time during the abdominal massage to, like, come at a different angles and talk. And with 15 minutes, there isn't that kind of time. So it just feels, you know, and it's fine. Sometimes you only see a person once, and then, you know, just occasionally they'll come back, and then you do have the opportunity to sort of, you know, delve in a little bit more. But, yeah, for me, the time is a little bit challenging. Mm. But it's also, you know, it's its own thing, so it's a nice challenge to try and do it within that time frame. But it can be a little difficult.
How about you, Andrea?
I mean, I'm thinking about the time thing, because I definitely talk too much to people. But I think within that, it's not just that it's the time. It's sometimes I'm asking a bunch of questions, and I'm not as good at honing down, like, do I really know why I'm asking that question, or am I just kind of trying to fill out a bunch of information? You know, and it's, I think it ends up coming back and informing things, but it's hard to actually work with sometimes when I get too much.
Yeah.
So I think that's kind of a challenge for me, is like I need to be a little bit more maybe discerning.
But it's like, it's like a puzzle, and you just want more.
Yeah.
It's totally a puzzle.
Well, I'm just waiting for you to say that one thing that's just going to be like, oh, yeah, okay. Yeah. You know, rarely does it work that way.
As practitioners, we all have strategies and ways to help solve the puzzle before us. And it's interesting how we've all learned to navigate with patients to lead them to a better understanding of themselves and their health. I think a lot of people come very convinced about, they're like, okay, this is what I have, so I know this is the relevant information, so this is what I'm going to give you. And I'm like asking them about other things, and I know that to them it's irrelevant, and they're trying to do me a favor, actually. Mm-hmm. They're like really trying to do me a favor by not talking about their emotional lives.
I'm being concise for you, yeah.
Yeah, but I want them to know that everything is relevant to me, and not in a creepy way.
I'm thinking about like how over time there would be people that were a little bit more of the like, well, I have this pain, so this is kind of what we're focusing on, and then we'll have these different conversations where they'll be like, well, so I've never talked about it before, but I also have this other thing that's going on, and maybe that's a connection to you that I don't know, that I don't understand.
Right.
Yeah.
But we've worked together on some other things, and maybe you can have a go at that, you know, and then they start to kind of like peel back their belief in that way.
It's kind of interesting because I haven't run into, if anything, about that concept of the universe sending you the patients that you need rather than vice versa, or maybe they also go to the right practitioner sometimes, but I tend to get people who are willing to share, you know, and often it's like they're not sure what it is. So they don't have anything specific, but it's this general, you know, fatigue, tiredness, a lot. I get a lot of that stress, and I'm always going, well, where does that manifest in your body? It's almost like I'm trying to pinpoint where they're feeling it in their bodies rather than they're coming to me saying, specifically, this part hurts. It would be good for people to know, because I'm always asking, you know, oh, when did that start happening? And often it's, you know, several years ago, and I'll always ask, oh, well, what was going on in your life? Did something happen then? And
it's so,
so often, it's you absolutely something has happened, and it's emotional and it's some sort of trauma. I mean, it just every time, it's almost always the case, and then we can start working from that. So
and
it's
sometimes
great to be
they
trusted.
Never made that connection, which is so, and it's such a simple thing, right? And it's like, oh, if that's the only thing you get from this, it feels like that's so much,
right?
It is amazing the simple connections that people don't make, right? Like when you ask that question.
Well, people can be really out of touch with their bodies. They don't even know if you're asking them a specific question. It's like, don't know where they feel it.
When patients do make connections of things in their lives related to their health and well-being, miracles can happen.
But the other more common miraculous treatments is something more commonplace when I do feel that people's complete understanding of their bodies and their lives change from Chinese medicine and from the ongoing conversations we have with it and just orienting themselves completely differently to their body. It's almost like they're let out of a prison or something. And that exhilaration of them discovering themselves and a different way of thinking about their health and well-being. I love that. That's more and more, you know. So that's to me what makes practicing the medicine worthwhile.
That idea of a more common miracle, like, it just makes me smile, like, just thinking about that, when you're like, oh, well, you know, the usual everyday stuff that happens.
But that is, like,
but
so
no, it's,
amazing.
It is. It's huge. I remember, like, last week, there's a woman that I've been working with for a while. We have done some massage, too. Like, a reminder that, like, there can be little shifts or a nice relaxing experience and da-da-da-da-da, and, like, a few months in, she's like, that really shifted. Like, I have not had this same pain. Like, I'm totally engaging parts of my body in a way that I have not been able to comfortably for ever or for a really long time, you know? And it's like that reminder that it took a little bit of time, and there are little shifts, and it takes getting comfortable, and it takes those, like, rethinking about how you're connecting to your body and the things that you're putting into it and the ways that you're talking to yourself about the world and your place in it and how that all lives in your body. Like, that whole idea of it being a way of life, like, they start to get that.
Yes.
And it's really freaking cool.
Why you gotta whisper that?
I know. It really is freaking cool when patients get that TCM is a way of life and that everything we do and choose affect our health, our jobs, our relationships, our homes, to name a few. We shared stories about patients and friends who begin to realize this and some potentially big changes that they may have to take.
I think when Rosemary had talked about the guy who was in the wrong job and, you know, and it wasn't going to change unless he actually changed that. And that's a hard thing to ask someone to do. It's just like, you know, you need to actually quit your job and find something else to do.
I love asking people, telling people to do that. I pride myself every time somebody tells me they leave their job. I'm like, yes.
Exactly. That's what I'm getting at. It's a hard thing to say. It's a big ask. And often people are like, I can't quit, you know. Yeah. But then when they do and they shift, that's exactly the thing. I think that's a miracle. It's like, wow, that's a huge decision. I feel like I've had a part in that, and that's going to be make such a difference. And then you see them in whatever new thing that they, you know, decided to do, and it's wonderful. You can see the difference. They feel the difference in their bodies, and that's just a miracle to see.
Yeah. So. I mean, to experience the world and see the world and your life in a completely different way than you did before, that's a miracle.
When patients understand qi patterns in their life and how it may negatively affect their health, big changes can occur, like changing jobs, relationships, schooling, moving to different places to live. Big changes that may feel scary because, after all, we've committed to these things for good reasons. At least, they all started with a good enough reason. But if over time they become a source of stress or strain, recurring illness and unhappiness, then the best solution for one's health would be to make these big changes. Which, more times or not, I find that patients
are aware of this, but they hold on because big changes are scary. Having a look at why we hold on, the fear involved, the thinking that maintains a particular disharmonious chi pattern, and getting support with TCM through it all, often a patient makes an easeful, if not initially easy, transition, and then looks back from a healthier place, wondering why they held on for so long to begin with. This is the depth that medicine can offer. It's hard to convey all that TCM has to offer because we're so used to seeing medicine through the lens of a modern Western paradigm, which is a way to quickly relieve symptoms, to take pain and discomfort away. And the remedies involved in that way of thinking are often isolated and short-sighted. I do think it's necessary to have medicines that provide immediate relief. After all, if your home is on fire, it's no time to talk about feng shui. In that case, Western medicine or acupuncture and herbs can put out that fire. However, medicine shouldn't stop there. We should think about how to prevent fires altogether. Perhaps when we rebuild, we need to move homes, consider different building materials, teach ourselves to be more careful with our habits. If we extended medicine and really emphasized the importance of prevention or living wellness, then there would be far fewer fires to put out. Rosie, who was an intern at BCA for the last year, talked about confronting difficult cases in the clinic and the challenges inside her of practicing TCM in both immediate and preventive ways.
I think one has been seeing people with a litany of different things and people who are just clearly in and have been in a lot of pain for a long time and just wanting to support them in like trying to get out of some sort of pattern that's potentially contributing to perpetuating the pain or something like that. And then I think the other thing that I think about, it's not a specific case, but it's like a challenge. Probably the biggest one for me, because I've been conditioned in a Western paradigm, I can feel how I'm, because of that heavy conditioning, I'm looking in the moment at Chinese medicine through that lens. And I'm trying to just employ what I've learned in that framework. And I can feel the limitations of that, like in the moment, I can feel it. And so, you know, it's always been helpful to talk to you and hear how you approach things, and it helps to shift it. But I think what it really highlighted for me is just how heavy that conditioning was. Yeah. That even in learning in this other way and having a very strong desire to see outside of that system, the conditioning is feels like almost like concrete blocks or something like that. And so I think it's been useful for me to feel that in myself and actually kind of like extrapolate into other parts of my life. It's like doesn't just end at Western medicine. All of the ways that I've been conditioned in this way that are limiting my not just understanding of healing, but my understanding of life and living and being on this planet and my understanding and how I feel in connection or not with the rest of the universe and everything around me. I think feeling that rub has been really useful for me.
Rosie's experience of the heavy conditioning that underlies not just how we see medicine, but a lot of other things, was uncovered as she studied TCM. This conditioning is a worldview of separation, the default way we understand the world. We approach such a world differently, feeling that things can exist in neat compartments and are controllable within the rules of those compartments, not touched by other elements of life. We see pain and disease as localized in physical area with which we locate it, and we zoom in to figure out how to get rid of it. We're not conditioned to think of that pain as being connected to other aspects inside our body, much less anything else related outside of our body. Without understanding the connections, we feel disconnected from things that seem to randomly happen to our bodies, and we feel powerless. So we seek the help of a doctor who may better understand the confusing and seemingly random things that afflict us. If we get a doctor who can solve the problem or take the pain away without illuminating what the pain may be connected to,
then we may repeat the behavior that causes that pain. And if this happens, then we become dependent on the treatment for relief. But if we get someone that can both relieve the pain and also illuminate for us all that may be connected to the pain, then we ourselves are empowered to make choices for ourselves. That approach isn't exclusive to TCM, of course. It's about the individual practitioner's orientation and worldview. A Western doctor can treat pain and help a patient in understanding and prevention, and conversely, a TCM practitioner can treat pain without making any of these connections for their patients. It can get tricky because, of course, there are many shades of all of these things, and that's when the different shades of different practitioners come into play. Listening to KPFA's 94.1's About Health. This is Twi, your host, and I'm talking to Andrea and Rosie about the different approaches to medicine.
Yeah, when I reflect on my entry into all of that, it's exactly that. Like yearning for some other way of understanding healing. I mean, even though it was like a short time, it has done that for me in quite a profound way, actually. Mm-hmm. So it sort of lays the groundwork for whatever happens next in my life, you know, of course.
But nutrition didn't do that for you.
No.
But that's considered an alternative type.
But nutrition brought you to this.
Yeah, I mean, yes, because it was maybe not in like a direct sort of way, but because I did it and then Western medicine wasn't working, then I turned towards nutrition, which was considered alternative, you know. But in many ways, it just is within the same framework, you know.
I think a lot of people are still looking for acupuncture to be within that same framework, for better or worse. Like, there's some aspects to that that I can understand. It's like, yes, let's quote-unquote legitimize ourselves, but there's a danger of losing a lot of the soul of it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's kind of like TCM itself. Versus like some of the classical Chinese medicine or, you know, going into traditional healing in a lot of different places. It's starting to be more translated into this kind of Western paradigm of medicine. And they're like, well, we're integrating it, except that we're not really, because we still have to diagnose based on their diagnoses, not ours.
Right.
Like it's, I don't know, it's kind of strange.
It's almost like, okay, you can be an acupuncturist and be a healer, but you can also be like, anyone and also be a healer, and healing can happen in all sorts of
ways. It's just being a human with another human.
Right, in a way that is outside of the system where healing and medicine is only acknowledged in a certain way. So through that lens, it's like some sort of prescription, whatever it is, like around nutrition or lifestyle or even in these like alternative health models. It's like, this is the recipe for having a healthy life. But it's like, there's so much other else that is not acknowledged. And so it's like even hard for us to acknowledge and recognize within ourselves when we feel it and know it. So it's hard to name it as such. And instead, we're trained to go towards like a formula or a recipe, even if it is seemingly outside of the system, because in the Western medicine system, maybe food and lifestyle isn't acknowledged as much. So we think outside of that is getting more fresh air or like, you know, playing in the dirt or something like that. But it's still in the same system because of its formulaic.
Prescriptive mode.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. But it's not about the details. You can eat Cheetos and whatever.
It's the nutritionist, board certified.
Hot Cheetos or regular Cheetos?
But it's your orientation to all of it. The details aren't important. It's the peace and contentment comes from your orientation to everything.
The orientation that Rosie is talking about emphasizes the inherent empowerment in mutually positive, interconnected, symbiotic relationships, which has a very different flavor than an orientation that is compartmentalized, prescriptive, hierarchical, and often disempowering. Hearing Rosie, a nutritionist, say that it's less about what you eat and more about how you feel about what you eat is refreshing, to say the least. But Rosie's personal orientation exists at a part of the spectrum that maybe less people can access. It feels so scary. We are conditioned within a paradigm that emphasizes control over trust, and typically when we seek help, we are seeking knowledge that we feel is beyond our reach. The problem, we think, is the Cheetos, located inside the Cheetos, like a headache is located in our head. So that should be an easy solution. If we can just get rid of the Cheetos or take painkillers for the headache, the problem should be solved. But does it really? Does it get rid of our impulse or get rid of our predisposition? Or does the impulse and pain just get transferred elsewhere and, if allowed, will return to the same place? This more connected and deeper way of understanding healing is more representative of how we do things at BCA. I like the word practice because it connotes that there's always more to learn. And I like the word balance because maintaining balance within a changing world and a changing body is an ongoing process. Traditional Chinese medicine is a living practice and art, and maybe that's why I never tire of it and love it so much. It's dynamic with endless learning and creativity and imbued with beautiful healing relationships. It was good to hear this reflected as I talked to other practitioners at the clinic, Yipei and Andrea.
I'm lucky, that I'm still able to practice, even though not as much as other people do. But I think it would be more draining. I don't know whether I could do this full time, but I do feel like my Saturdays are really the highlight of my day or my week because it's something I can do and come in, and I always feel like I've made a difference, even if I've touched, just six or seven people's, made them better. And it's very direct and immediate. And of course, I do another job, right? So I work as an engineer as well, and that is obviously really different, but everything I do is very long-term conceptual and planning. You just don't know whether those projects will ever come to pass. Whereas in acupuncture, I know exactly I get to speak one-on-one with someone, and I know I made a difference every single time. And it's always good. It's always a positive experience. So absolutely, I'm so lucky.
Wow.
That I found it, yeah. And, really enjoy learning more every time.
The instant feedback is amazing.
Exactly, yeah.
I mean, when I think about, I can't imagine what other kind of work I would do.
Wow.
I was working retail for a long time, and I did some waitressing. I could do that kind of stuff, but, seeing so many people in office jobs, I'm like, I don't know if I could do that. So I feel very, very lucky to have found it. And like she said, that it just keeps changing and growing. You can kind of go down this little rabbit hole or that one. And there's always so much more to learn, which is a little bit daunting.
Right.
And you can just go nuts. But I love exploring it. I like the way that it's kind of unfolding and enriching my life. It's not just a job. It is a lifestyle. Even when I'm not practicing as much as I want to what I'm preaching, it really all is informing conversations that I'm having, choices that I'm making all the time. So I'm pretty happy. I feel very, very, very lucky.
I feel quite lucky as well to be able to practice a medicine whose roots contain profound and sacred teachings of how to live in harmony, balance, and ultimately peace. I feel that this is the type of medicine that is being called forth in our world today. And I feel encouraged that over the years, I've inspired few people like Rosie to follow this path. However, what I've come to realize is that the path that people are attracted to is less about learning how to stick needles in people and more about how to live in harmony with the ever-changing world and the ever-changing self. And that can be pursued in whatever discipline your heart leans toward. Oftentimes, it just requires leaning into an interconnected view of wherever you find yourself. This way of looking at things can be, in and of itself, the medicine.
When I practice TCM at the clinic, there's an awareness that I'm very much connected to both the imbalances and the resolutions that patients bring in more ways than I may be aware of. The acupuncturists have alluded to these connections throughout the program, and perhaps the connection is more intimate than we typically think of it. The idea of connection isn't an intellectual conceptual thing to take into consideration. It's a dance that we are all continuously a part of. Patient, practitioner, the phone ringing, the bird outside, the cold day, and so on. All of it informs our well-being more than we can fathom. If we can feel into this, a natural sense of respect and reverence for all of life arises. That sense of connection and gratitude is what brings about a natural balance. When we do acupuncture, the needles are restoring a natural balance of the body that's connected to the natural balance of the universe. How far that restoration of balance can go depends on how far we ourselves allow and understand our own connection to all that is. The more we can zoom out of an individualistic, isolated view of ourselves and our lives, the further healing can extend. When I first thought to get all of us practitioners together to talk about TCM, I envisioned the opportunity to hear a variety of views and practices of TCM that would broaden the scope of the medicine. And some of that did happen, but what really struck me was actually how similar our collective approach is. That shouldn't be too surprising to me. After all, we all practice at BCA and we've been together for years. But the contrast between what I expected, which was a display of our different approaches, and what actually happened, which felt more like a reinforcement of the same approach, an understanding of the depth of TCM, was a beautiful reminder to me that indeed, we are all connected. A tremendous thank you to my acupuncture sisters, Rosemary, Ipe, Andrea, and Rosie for indulging me in this interview and sharing so generously your thoughts on the practice of TCM. Berkeley Community Acupuncture is the healing haven that it is because of your dedicated practice and contributions to our beautiful community. Thank you, thank you, thank you. If you'd like to make an appointment with any one of these skilled and wise practitioners, you can go to bcaclinic.com. A special thanks to Daniel Burgess, another skilled practitioner of bodywork at BCA, and as well a talented sound engineer of these programs. And thank you to Poddington Bear at soundofpicture.com for the music you are hearing on this program today. I'll see you next month for another thought-provoking program on About Health at KPFA 94.1.
Robin D.G. Kelly.
Critical race theory actually is a legal mode of analysis that comes out of law that basically asks the fundamental question, that is, how is it we can get all this legislation passed that is supposed to protect people from racism, like from the 14th Amendment to the Civil Rights Act to the Voting Rights. How can we have these things and racism still persists? And so the argument is that as lawyers, as legal scholars, we can't always look at legislation and policy as the explanation or even the form of power that could solve the problem. You have to look elsewhere. So critical race theory says, look, you need to look at other structures of power, including ideological structures. That is the way that people think. What's the common sense? And that's it.
Storytelling for social change on KPFA. A
Attention KPFA listeners. Upfront PM is off for the next 2 weeks and will return on the first day of our spring fun drive, February 21st. Up next, we are proud to bring you a series of encore broadcasts from our recent Black History Month special, originally aired on Sunday, February 5th. Stay tuned.
Listening to 94.1 KPFA,
89.3 KPFB in Berkeley,
KFCF 88.1 FM in Fresno,
97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz,
and online worldwide
at kpfa.org.